see everyone this evening. And for the time that we have allotted, we're going to be discussing the subject of godly men. Before I begin, I want to say I really appreciate the hospitality of this congregation. The Brewsters, Brother Moses, Lois and Betty. Now, of course, that's a crew. Y'all know that. But they've been very good to me as far as meals and conversation. It's always good to meet Brother Landon and his good wife. You know, you're fortunate now to have a gospel preacher who does the work of an evangelist, 2 Timothy 4 and 5, because so many places, really, you just don't have evangelists that actually preach the gospel in its pure form. And that's becoming somewhat of a rarity, especially when you get into larger, more metropolitan areas. You know, the rural congregations, seemingly, by and large, have done a better job at holding the truth, and that may be because they're more linked to agriculture. Not much with agriculture changes. Implements and methods change, but the seasons and the fact that crops are sown and harvested, there's a commonality of stability there. And that may be one of the reasons that people that are more agriculture-based seemingly do a better job, by and large, of not getting carried away with every new thing that comes along. Godly men. Now, we could go a million ways with this. And I suppose we just may do that. Think back. Think back about all the godly men of the Old and New Testament. But the Scripture gives to us in some way to light a fire within us so that we might be the kind of men that we ought to be. Godly men is what we need today in the church. The world needs more godly men. You know, every one of you here tonight, you have a candle within you. Everybody, you have a candle within you. If you're in Christ, you are to be His light set upon a hill. The reflected, magnified light of Christ within our hearts to a dark world. Jesus did not pray that we were taken out of the world, John the 17th chapter. He did not pray that His Father would take the disciples out of this world, but that we simply would not be of this world. And we have a candle within us. And sometimes this candle has grown dark and cold, and it is not illuminating nor reflecting the light of Christ in the communities in which we reside. Others have candles that are bright, candles that are burning for the Lord, candles that are reflecting His might and His power in the respective places of our abode. Godly men, Matthew 5, we are to let our light so shine before men that others may see our good works and glorify our Father who art in heaven. We are to magnify Christ in this life. Godly men, however, going all the way back to the Old Testament, men like Noah. You talk about a man of faith who was preparing an ark during a course of a 120-year period before finally the heavens opened, the rains began to descend. A man who only his family were saved, according to 1 Peter, the 3rd chapter, verses 19 and 20. Wherein a few, that is, 8 souls were saved by water. Noah was a man that moved in great fear of the Lord and obeyed God. In fact, Genesis 6, 22 says, Noah did all that God said, so did he. That's the kind of man that we want to be. Godliness means that we have a heart of obedience. And obedience to the things of God. 1 John 5 and 3, if we love Him, we'll keep His commandments. And you know, John 14 and 15 says the same thing in a different way. We are to uphold the teaching of God, and in doing so, we therefore obey, Romans 6 and 17, from the heart, that's the inner man, Romans 7, all the things of God with a pure motive. Love is important. It's not just that we're keeping a command, but that we have the right motivation. In fact, the Bible says, the entirety of Jesus speaking, of the whole law and prophets could be summarized in 2 commandments. The first is love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, strength, and mind. And the second likened to it, love thy neighbor as thyself. For this, Jesus said, the entire law and prophets hang upon these two. Jesus didn't come to knock down the Old Testament, but He fulfilled it. And therefore, the 2 tablets of stone, the Decalogue, the 10 commandments, really can be summarized in 2. And those same 2 points are spoken in the New Testament, and we therefore are to love our God and our fellow man. Love means that we are to have the best interest of the other person in heart. A godly man recognizes the need to love his God and his fellow man. We're to love one another in the church. In fact, Hebrews 13:1 says, let brotherly love continue. The Bible asks this question. If we cannot love our brother whom we have seen, how then can we love, according to 1 John, our Father or God whom we have not seen? Love is vital, and godly men have love. In fact, 1 Corinthians 13, Paul said, these three, faith, hope, and charity. Those are the three that are remaining the time which the epistle was written. But, Paul said, the greatest of these is charity or love. Why? Because hope will be realized. Faith will become sight in the eternal realm. But only charity has an endless circle. No end, no beginning to her definition, and she will last throughout all the ages. That's why the definition is correct. For God is love. And therefore, if we do not love each other, beloved, we do not know the love of God. For this is the love of God, that we love one another. This is not a new commandment that he has given us, but the same commandment, that we love one another. So we're to let brotherly love, Hebrews 13:1, continue. In fact, Paul said, love does not seek evil. 1 Corinthians 13. It does not seek itself. It does not rejoice in evil. If we were to give our bodies to be burned, and that's obviously a figure of speech, but if we were to do the ultimate sacrificial test, if we were to give our bodies to be burned, or if we were to give all that we had as a sacrifice to relieve the hunger of the world, or for those in a benevolent act of kindness to those who need, if we were to bestow all of our monetary considerations to the poor, and yet we have not love, how much does it profit us? None. Why? Because if we do not do all things by love, then the act itself is of no merit or of no kind. That's why the scripture says we're to speak the truth, Ephesians 4:15, in love. Love, Peter says, covereth a multitude of sins. So godly men are given to the doctrine of love. Godly men are given to the subject, given to the concept, to impress upon all those around them the importance of being spiritual. The Bible says we are to be spiritual. In the church, when someone goes astray, who are we going to send after? Those who've gone astray. Galatians 6:1 says, brethren, if a brother be overtaken in a fault, ye who are spiritual can't have carnal men going to try to retrieve a lost sheep, because carnal men don't have the maturity, the discipline, the fortitude, and the spiritual concept of how to retrieve a lost sheep. The Bible says the blind lead the blind. What's going to happen? They both will fall in the ditch. And so here, the Bible is instructing us that those who are spiritual are to go and to restore such a one. Notice how spiritual or godly men think, considering themselves, lest they also be tempted. A carnal man will go out to retrieve somebody, and he'll fall in the same ditch the other brother's already in. A spiritual man knows first that he must discipline himself before he does anything. Spiritual, what does that mean? It means one whose inner man, see, we have a tabernacle. We all have a tabernacle. Remember one time I was reading the episode concerning John Quincy Adams. And a man came up to him and he asked him. He was old at this point of his life. And they said, Mr. Adams, how are you doing? He said, my tabernacle is about worn out. He said, but John Quincy Adams is doing remarkably well. Could that not be said of many of our older folks in the church? Sometimes the tabernacle is wearing out. We know that it's not going to be long in which we're going to drop the tent of this body. But your inner man can be as good tonight as it's ever been. Because man is composed of three. Body, soul, and spirit. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. And Romans 7 talks about that inner man, the soul. And the soul of man has value. And godly men recognize the value of the soul. And those who recognize the value of the soul are therefore in Scripture defined as spiritual. Because people that value the soul flee from the world. Jesus said, highly spiritual, the most spiritual among all. Jesus said that a man's life does not consist in the abundance of that which he possesses. That's why he said, beware of covetousness. And he also said in the book of Mark, chapter 8, the latter part, 36 and 7. What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what should a man give in exchange for his soul? Jesus knew that being spiritual meant not loving the world. Now, Demas, we learned last night, who was not a godly man, he was at one time, but he lost his godliness. He left his godliness, and he went after the world, 2 Timothy 4 and verse 10. And in pursuing the world, he left behind the spiritual man. And in doing so, he forfeited his relationship with the Apostle Paul and God. That's interesting. Paul said, he has. That's right. He has forsaken me. Godly men really don't hang around constantly those who are carnal. I know some object to this point. It's, oh, preacher, you missed it on that one. I finally got you. Jesus ate with the publicans and sinners. Tell me, dear friend, good Bible student, did Jesus spend the majority of his time with those or with his disciples, with the 70, with the 12 and the inner three, Peter, James, and John? And a close reading of the New Testament, you'll find that he was most around those of like precious faith. He was the master and he was teaching the disciples. Sure, he rubbed elbows with those sinners in the world to teach and to give evidences for his identity and the message of the word. But it's not that he was mingling with these people so that he might become their best friend. He was mingling with them so that he might teach them of the gospel, or that is, the coming of the gospel. I want to make that point clear, because too many people today, they lose godliness because they don't associate with those who are godly. Show me a godly man, I'll show you someone when he gets to the ripe age that he's going to go out and select a partner for life, a lady. You show me a true godly man, I'll show you a godly man by the woman he selects. Now, he selects a barfly, he's not godly. I don't care what you say. You can argue all day long. Preacher, don't say you have to marry a Christian. You're not reading your Bibles. In 1 Corinthians 9, Paul is arguing about marrying somebody. He's saying he has the right to marry a believing woman. If your spouse passes away, you're to marry only in the Lord. 1 Corinthians 7:39. You're to seek the kingdom first. Matthew 6 and 33. Amos 3:3. How can two walk together except they be agreed? Why would a godly man go to the bar looking for a wife? In fact, what would a godly man be doing at the bar anyways? Oh, preaching. You know these liberal preachers today, I hate to say it, they know just enough Bible to be dangerous, but not enough to get it right. They say, well, I'd go to the bar because Jesus ate with sinners and publicans. Again, they've missed the bar completely. Jesus did not go to condone and to intermingle and to make an appearance so that he might get as close to the people of sin as he could. He went to those people to teach them. You let a man go to the bar and stand up and preach the gospel. You tell them what Jesus told the woman at the well, go and sin no more, and see if they invite you back to the bar again. You go into the bar and you're sitting down and you're having a beer with these people. You're not there to teach them. You're there to live like them. And I am ashamed of our brethren who think when we can go to the bars and the casinos and all these places where Satan lives and think that we're going to lay down with the dogs and not get fleas. Should have been an amen on that one. You can't lay down with the dogs and not get fleas. And don't misquote a scripture. Actually, the quotation's right. He ate with sinners. But don't misapply the scripture to justify our own sins. Don't bring Jesus into your sin. Because Jesus taught plainly concerning the holiness of man. He told that woman to do what? Don't sin anymore. Because if you've had four or five spouses and you're shacked up with another one, something's wrong. There's sin involved in that. Y'all see that? In fact, the Bible says a godly man is supposed to stay with the wife of his youth. Malachi chapter 2. Why? Because verse 16 says God hateth divorce. God hates divorce. But we've got churches now on the sign, divorce recovery. We ought to be preaching against divorce, not starting divorce recovery programs. Y'all see this? I'm all for people finding forgiveness. I believe God allows people an opportunity to repent and to be forgiven. But it's like the mission of the church today is almost, again, is to lay down with the dogs. And I know what it is. So many places, numbers are down. People are seemingly not interested sometimes in spiritual matters. And so we think, well, maybe, just maybe, we'll start all these, maybe we'll let Alcohol Anonymous meet here. And maybe we'll do the divorce recovery program. And we'll do this, and we'll do that. That's a socialized gospel. Paul didn't preach that. He taught the gospel. The church's mission is to teach the gospel. And if somebody wants to repent, I'm just going to say it like this. You don't have to have Alcoholics Anonymous. I don't believe that. And I've heard people all my life in the church say, well, that's a disease. Alcohol is just like fornication or dope or gambling or cussing. You can overcome it if you want to by the help of God. And if you can't, then that means man is not a free moral agent. See this? Don't tell me you can't overcome sin. Someone said, well, once you're an alcoholic, you're always an alcoholic. No, sir. Paul was a murderer. Did he die a murderer? No, because he was washed and sanctified in the blood of Christ. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11. There were homosexuals, sodomites, whoremongers, thieves, extortioners, people who practiced witchcraft. And all of those people and many more listed in the catalog of sins, guess what they had? One thing in common. Those that were sanctified had contacted the blood of Jesus, and the Bible says, such were some of you. See, Satan messes with people. We need clear, forthright teaching. Godly men. Godly men are not going, again, to lay down with the dogs to get fleas. Demas did it, and you know what? When he woke up, he didn't have Paul as his best friend anymore, and he didn't have a relationship with God. Because when you do that, you forfeit your soul. You ever heard someone say, once you're saved, you're always saved? That's not true. No way. Explain 2 Timothy 4:10. Was Demas at one time saved? Sure he was, because he was a co-worker of the Apostle Paul. But Paul says, he's forsaken me. Can we forsake God and Paul, that is the apostles' teaching, and be right with God? Why would Paul be grieving and put it in a letter if the relationship had not changed? Sure, you can lose your salvation. And you know what? Here's the good news. God's merciful, and godly men recognize the grace and mercy of God. God's grace and mercy puts limits on Satan. Satan doesn't have a free-for-all with you like some people think. See, some of y'all are blaming too much on the devil. You do say, well, Satan made me do it. The devil didn't make you do anything. You, in your moral depravity, not that you were born depraved, you were not born depraved. Calvinism teaches that. But you can become depraved in your morality when you yield to your own lust, James 1. The devil didn't make you do anything. When you give in and you pursue the temptation, and when that temptation builds with lust, and when the lust is fulfilled, James says it bringeth forth what? Death. God is merciful. The story of Job tells me Job was a godly man. Godly men sometimes have struggles. Just because we're living godly doesn't mean that we're going to be removed from the pitfalls and the poor circumstances of this life. He had his finances stripped. His wife told him to curse God and die. His children, everything was taken. But here's the grace and mercy of God. There's a box around Job. At least in one sense, Satan cannot do what? He can't touch the soul. That same box is around you. You know that? Did you know that? Excuse me. Improper grammar. Satan cannot touch your soul. Now, he can tempt you. He can come at Landon and he can come at me with the pride of life, the lust of the eyes, and the lust of flesh. 1 John 2, 15 through 17. That's all he's got, those three. That's it. Sure, he masquerades himself as an angel of light. He's a player. That's all Satan is a player. He's a hypocrite. He's a liar and a thief. He's destructive. And that's why people who teach a false doctrine, false teachers, are Satan's helpers. They're liars. Satan is the father of what? All liars. And so people who teach a corrupt gospel really have been begotten of Satan, and they're his sons. Y'all know everybody has a daddy. Y'all know that? Everybody has a daddy. And a false teacher's daddy is Satan. Because Satan's the father of all lies. And so a gospel that's corrupted is a lie. Satan's the father of all of those. And so one that teaches a corrupt gospel is the son of, in that sense at least, Satan, child of the devil. Here's what I want you to see. Godly men recognize the grace of God and the mercy of God even amongst the storms of lying. I hope we never suffer like Job had to suffer. But the story there, and I say story, not implying fiction, story meaning a real divine episode, that this teaches me that the worst case scenario, I can be faithful no matter my circumstances, because this one thing will always be true. Satan cannot touch your soul. God has limits, aren't you glad? And you know what? With every storm, after the storm passes, the birds sing, there's a still breeze, there's a calm after the storm. And God's mercy does not allow anybody to live in a storm continually. Every person in the Bible had breaks from the storm, even Jesus. He had the Garden of Gethsemane. He had many horrible days, but you know, Jesus also had many mornings of relaxation. When he departed, Mark 1:35, before daybreak into a solitary place, and there he prayed. He had many, many hours of joy teaching and training his disciples. He had many wonderful, intimate moments with the three, Peter, James, and John. So everybody, even Jesus, who suffered all for us, had moments of joy and moments of goodness on this earth. Godly men, I mentioned earlier, keep the wives of their youth. We've just got too much divorce in the church today. You know, I mean, y'all realize in some places, this is the truth. This happens. I know it's happened. Some places, I'm a preacher, I just say, you know what? I like her. I mean, I'm a married man, but I just think I like her now. They call it a midlife crisis. There's no need. You know what it's called really in the scripture? Sin. There you go again, making a name for something. There's no such thing as a, it's just sin. Teenagers get carried away, and they say, oh, they're just sowing their wild oats. See, you're just making a name for it. It's sin. We make excuses for one thing after another. If I take his wife, whose wife is she? Landon's wife. The Bible says that she belongs to him and him to her. They're under a covenant, God at the top. What God had joined together, Mark 10:9, let not man put asunder. Whosoever, if I put away my wife, now listen to this. If I put away my wife and take up with her, what's the scripture say? Whosoever putteth away his wife and marrieth another committeth what? Adultery. You can't, what do you mean? We got TV shows now. Wife swap. We've got more immorality in our country than we've ever had. Oh, immorality is not new, world over. It's always been bad. But in our own country, the level of immorality is on the increase. That's affecting the church. And that's why instead of preaching against divorce in many places, we're now in the recovery mode. Because if we preach too strong, we'll lose too many people. But you know what? Sometimes there needs to be a weed eating, a purging. Because some of these people in the pews, I hate to say it, are not spiritual. And so we can't just go by how many numbers we have on a tote board. Ultimately, God judges the hearts of men. And if people are truly going to be saved, they have to come to a knowledge of the truth. I don't have any right to look at his wife. Godly men train their eyeballs. When I look at his wife, I better look at her eye to eye, right? You want me looking at her any other place? No, her eyes. And I ought to learn to look at her as my sister. That's who she is. How would you look at your own sister? She's my sister in Christ. I also look at her as one of my good friends' wives. brings up an interesting story. Remember David? In a weak moment, full of sin, full of lust, he looked down and saw Bathsheba bathing. Do you know who she was married to? That's right. Uriah the Hittite. See the providence of God? One last chance David had. Lust was building. He's visually stimulated. Instead of immediately praying and stopping, he allowed the temptation to get the best of him. He gives in to it. And remember when the servant, he tells the servant to go get her, basically? The servant says, you mean Bathsheba, Uriah, the Hittite's wife? See what I mean? She's not just Christian. In this episode, she would be Kristen, your good friend Landon's wife. See that? Godly men look at other women the right way. And that begins when you're young, boys. You ought to look at girls and the opposite sex the right way. Women are not to be abused. Women are not to be talked down to. You don't have the right when you start dating young men to put your paws on somebody. Get your paws off of them. Amen. Because you know what? You're going to have a girl someday. And that guy's going to do the same thing you're doing to her. Is that all right? See? Same with me, right? That's impressive. Until you marry somebody, you don't need to put your paws on them. See, sometimes we just teach, well, just don't you know what? The Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says abstain from the appearance of evil. Y'all are going 70 miles an hour and trying to hit the brakes. You know what you're going to do one of these days? Yep, Sister Lois is right. You're going to run off the cliff. You can't drive 70 miles an hour in a school zone and not hit somebody. The teaching is not just to abstain from sexual intercourse. The teaching is to keep yourself pure and chaste. So a godly man looks at his prospective wife-to-be in the right way. I'm telling y'all, this is Bible teaching. And this is the kind of teaching we need. This is godly men. And godly men teach their daughters what a godly man is to be by the way he treats his wife. If you want your daughter someday to marry a barbarian, then go ahead and be a barbarian in the home. If you want your daughter someday to marry a gentle and kind, a firm man in the gospel, one who provides and protects and is a family man, and one who honors the Lord and is respectful in the community. If that's the kind of man you want your daughter to marry, then that's the kind of man you better be to your wife. Because godly men imitate Christ. There's a lot of people imitating a lot of various people. Now my son has a slight speech impediment. Now that he lost his two front teeth, that has somewhat, it's just really emphasized it. That's the way he talks like this sometimes. And he said, Dad, I'm trying to meditate. I said, meditate? What's that? Well, he got meditate, imitate confused. I preached on that one night. We ought to imitate Christ and meditate on the Word. He combined them and called it meditate. But you know what? I guess in that sense, we ought to be meditating. Meditate upon the word, godly men do, and imitate Christ. Who is there better to imitate? We've got all of these NFL people and all these NBA sports heroes and all of that. I'm not against sports, but they're not my heroes. Not a one of them. Some of y'all got these rock stars and all these country singers. I enjoy a little secular music when it's clean, but they're not my heroes. Most of them I wouldn't trade lives for. I enjoy some of their music, but the truth is, a lot of them are absolutely miserable. That's the truth. We've got people that, you know, they won't salute the flag, but we pay them millions of dollars. They're not my hero, to be honest with you. My hero's Jesus. My hero's Jesus, and I will imitate him because he had the love completely limitless that he would actually give his own life for the world being defined as the masses of humanity. Jesus died for all men, that all men might come to a saving knowledge of the truth. Isn't that powerful? Christ died for us. We can substitute toot our name in John 3:16 and do no harm to the passage in context. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We can say, for God so loved Lois. For God so loved Betty. For God so loved Landon. You can put your name in that passage and it makes it more personal, and it's true. God loved you at the cross. He had you on his mind. And the value of our souls, in part, is what kept him on the cross. Love is not defined merely in the articulation of words, but in the act signified. Love is action, thus demonstrated eloquently in Romans, the 5th chapter. For God, verse 8, commendeth his love toward us. Yet while we were sinners, Christ died. He acted on love. He died for the ungodly. Tell me that's not love. He died for the dogs. Those dogs we talked about with fleas, that is worldly living. People who are caught up in all types of sin, so confused and blinded by the god of this world that they have little to no ability to see. Christ died for every one of those. Yet he did not see us as dogs. He saw us as valuable commodities. That's why Hebrews says, what is man that thou art mindful of him? God condescended. He willingly tabernacled among us, John chapter 1, God with us. He tabernacled with us, came down. He made himself a little lower than the angels. That's human. For the purpose that we might be redeemed back to his Father. The song asked the question, if that isn't love, what is? If that's not love, someone tell us what love is. Everybody's looking today for something. And the hollow, vacant hearts and homes all across America. Sports is not going to fill that void. Secular education will not fill that void. All the wealth that one could amass is not going to fill that void. Why are people lonely and miserable and heartbroken? Because they obey not the teachings of God. They have not the heart of God within them. Proverbs 4, the Bible says, 23, that we are to guard our hearts. And the King James says, keep your hearts. For out of it proceed of all the issues of life. Everything that proceeds out of you concerning your life, your trajectory, your future. You want to look into the crystal ball? You know what the crystal ball is? Your heart. Everybody has a crystal ball. Your future is in your heart. And the Bible says what you eat does not defile you. Oh, people are on a health craze in America. I mean, we've got people gluten-free. We've got people. I'm not. It's okay. But I'm just saying people are just enamored with this lately. The truth is, I saw a preacher here out back, you know, pretty close. One of my friends talking about, well, it's better not to eat meat. Hogwash. Is that what the Bible says? 1 Timothy 4 says, the latter times some shall depart from the faith, verse 1, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons, having their conscience seared with the hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from meats. You weren't made to be merely a vegetarian. I don't believe that. If you were, then why does God say, don't forbid meat? If you wasn't designed to eat meat, God wouldn't allow you to eat meat. He'd command you not to eat meat. But people get crazy about things. You know, they just get crazy. So the point of it is, in all of these subjects that we're bringing up, godly men have an anchor the world doesn't have. Health craze won't fill the vacancy of your life. Going to gym 3 times a day won't fill the vacancy of your life. Y'all know that bodily exercise profits little. All these things are not going to fill that vacancy. Tell you what will fill it, the fruit of the Spirit. Remember love? First one in chronological order of no accident. love, peace, and joy. You know what will fill it? Having within you the Spirit of God. You know what will fill it? Being able to think about and to meditate upon the Scripture, 1 Timothy 4. Being able to recall the words of God to deal with Satan on a daily basis. You know what will fill it? Peace and righteousness and joy in the Holy Ghost, Romans, the 14th chapter. You know what will fill it? Hebrews 12 and 14. The Bible says we are to seek peace and holiness. Without such, no man shall see God. You know what will fill it? Being a good man to your wife and to your children. Provide and protect. Take them to services. Be a real man. Quit talking dirty and filthy and speak about things, according to Philippians 4, that are honorable and pure and just and praiseworthy. These things think upon. You know what will fill it? Prayer in the home. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse number 8, the Bible says, I will that men pray everywhere without wrath and doubt and lifting up holy hands. Why? Because these men, true godly men, understand that prayer is the very exercise of their Christianity, their exercise of their faith. That's why Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 5 and 17, pray without ceasing. Luke 18, that men ought always everywhere to pray. We need godly men who are committed to prayer. You want to fill that void? Focusing on Jesus. If we were to understand the passage that we shall see God, that is, with single eye, not one eye, in other words, with vision that looks solely towards the focus of spiritual things, namely the person of Christ, in whom Colossians 2 and 9 says, the whole Godhead dwelt bodily. If we would focus on Christ to the extent that all of the things were secondary, our life was going to be full. That's why Paul said he would be spent for the gospel. How can you be spent if you're not full? How can you teach what you don't know? Well, you have to have within your heart not a vacancy, but a continual standing of the word and prayer and spiritual things, the fruit of the Spirit, the kind of mentality and spirituality that was defined of Christ. Paul said that we have not so learned Christ. Who? Those of the church that were living like the Gentiles. The mind of Christ can be in us. Did you realize that? The same mind that Christ had, those same virtues and attributes, those can be in your mind. They're going to have to be to practice Ephesians chapter 4 and 32. Godly men practice forgiveness. Be ye kind, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, if we do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will our Heavenly Father forgive our trespasses. In fact, Jesus said in that same sermon that on our way to the altar to take our gift, if we remember that we have aught against our brother, we should lay the gift down. Isn't this a powerful passage? Don't worry about worshiping. Lay the gift down. Go be reconciled to thy brother, then come and offer thy gift. Is that taught in the church? Do you understand the point? Before you can take the Lord's Supper, if you have aught between a brother, the Lord's Supper, you're taking it in vain. You're drinking damnation to yourself. Lay the cup down is the teaching. Lay the worship aside. Not that worship's not important. That's not the teaching. The teaching is what? That your relationship to your brother is so important that there's no way to worship in spirit and in truth and have hatred towards a brother in the church. If there's sin, if there's aught, if there's something standing in there, take care of it first so that you can worship correctly. Forgiveness, godly men practice it. And I'm thankful because I've sinned against brethren before, and I'm sure you have as well. And we have to go and rectify and be humble and ask for forgiveness. And so if other people have forgiven me, I'm sure glad. Sure glad of that. Therefore, I must, of the same token of spirituality, be willing to forgive my brother who and when and if sins against me. Godly men, last point we're going to look at. Godly men have something to look forward to. You have a lot to look forward to. You have to look forward to a good name, Proverbs 22. A good name is rather to be chosen, verse 1, than silver and gold and all the wealth. A godly man has to look forward to the opportunity someday to serve the house of the Lord. Remember I was so honored the first time I was asked to wait on the Lord's table. That really was even more honoring than preaching to me. I didn't even read a scripture that day. I was too nervous and too young, really. I was about 14. But just the fact that I was able to pass those emblems down the aisle, that meant a great deal to me. Godly men recognized to serve as a priest in the house of the Lord is one of the highest honors you'll ever look forward to. You'll look forward to someday your children rising up and naming the Lord in baptism. And to be able to witness your own children someday when they enter in adolescence and obey the gospel, do you realize that's something to look forward to? There'll never be a happier day, probably, other than your marriage, other than your own baptism, to see your children who have grown up and have named the Lord in baptism. You'll have someday to look forward to not only a godly wife, because y'all remember, godly men don't go to the bar to find a wife. You'll have something to look forward to. You'll have growing old together. One marriage for life. That's God's intention. That's the design. That's the plan. Something else you'll have to look forward to someday is dying in peace. Now, death's still a struggle. I'll be honest with you. I don't know how many of you are familiar, but I mean, hey, I've always preached in rural areas except for Deer Creek. When I was at Lindsay, I mean, and I still preach some funerals there, 66 since 2003. Funerals. I've done that. 66. Now I always try to go visit somebody before they pass if I can. And I'm telling you, I've seen some of the tallest, strongest men of Western Oklahoma, big old ranchers, who when I first got to Lindsay, you know, I mean, these guys were 75 and 80 and could still take their hand around a post and just, you know how they do that? And I couldn't even do it. But all of a sudden, cancer got a hold of them. And they was drawn up in a fetal position, lost 100 or so pounds, looked like about the size of these young tots, all drawn up, just laboring for breath after breath, out of it. Now, I'm going to tell you something. When you get to that point, all that little stuff on TV, people been playing church, you better be in the church. You better be a godly man. You better be right with God. Because the moment when you, do you realize the moment when your soul leaves your body, you only die one time. All these people talking about dying twice and coming back, I went to heaven. Don't lie to me. The Bible says it's appointed once man to die. And I don't read any of those little books about people dying and coming back because none of them true. I've read the book, the Bible, and that's what I believe. Do y'all? You got to be careful what you read. I know this, but the Bible teaches. When you leave this earth, death is the separation of the body, soul, and spirit. Oh, you might flatline and bring you back, but you never died. You got close, you just never died. If you die, you ain't coming back. And the moment we die, godly men have something great to look forward to. Paradise and the eternal realm, and finally the heavenly home. You can look forward to that. You know, you can even look forward to the judgment day. The Bible says that he's going to reward us according to our works. We think of that as just hammering out the bad. But God rewards the righteous according to your works. That scares people in a world of grace theology nowadays. People have overcompensated to one area. They can't imagine works having anything to do. But the Bible says repeatedly, you're judged by your works. He rewards you according to your works. Godly men have the pursuit of heaven. There is no bigger prize. Heaven is our incentive. Christianity is a reward-based religion. Some might argue that point, but it's correct. Jesus said the reward that lieth at the end of the way. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, to an inheritance, incorruptible, undefiled, that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for whom? You. Whose letter addressed to? The saints. Godly men. Folks, when we leave this earth, that's it. You understand? That's it. We better be right with God. Godly men and godly women. Where are they headed? The heavenly home. Revelation 22, 14 in closing. Blessed are they. Blessed are they that keep his commandments, that they may have right, the tree of life, and enter in the gates to the city. Heaven is a city, not a fleshly city, but a figurative, spiritual city. a place where all the souls of the saints that are faithful, all the way back to Adam, will abide forever in the presence of God. There will be no sin, no nightness, no sorrow, no sickness, no pain, for the former things are passed away. This new heaven and new earth, 2 Peter 3:13, wherein dwelleth righteousness, is going to be a most fabulous reward for all the things in this life that we've had to suffer. And you know, some of our ancestors suffered a lot. I'm reminded of that one verse about Paul in Galatians 6, toward the end of the chapter, down about verse 17. He said, I bear the marks of Jesus in my own body. He physically received 40 stripes, save one, multiple times. He could lift up his shirt and prove his sufferings of the Lord. Our sufferings may not be that, but according to Matthew, the 10th chapter, a servant is not above his master. Our love is above our parents, Matthew 10:37. And we count the cost as a man going out and building a tower or a house. We count the cost before we decide to become a Christian. Because becoming a Christian, friend, is not easy. It's not easy. But I'll promise you this. It is the only life worth living. It is the only life that matters. And when we leave this earth, it's just exciting. Can you imagine someday just being able to hear these words? Lois, if the Lord says this, wouldn't this be grand? Lois, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Could you imagine the tears of joy that would come down? Of course, we realize we're not a fleshly body there, but figuratively speaking, could you imagine of all of the heartache and all the suffering in life, suddenly that burden is completely lifted and we're ushered into the gates to the heavenly home to dwell with all the saints, and not even the possibility of sin is in heaven because God is there. God dwells there. That's why no sin can enter heaven. Not absolutely not one little sin. That's why tonight, the only way you're going to go to heaven is if the blood of Christ hath forgiven you of your sin. That's the only way. You can't go to heaven with sin. You think God's going to let sin in his world? In his house? Yeah, godly men don't even let it in their house. But the Father is without sin. There is no sin in the Father's house. It's his house, his rules. You want to come into his house, you got to come into his church. Because his church is his house. Y'all see this? 1 Timothy 3:15, for thou oughtest know how to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of truth. Now, the house or the church is also the kingdom. Matthew 16:18-19. And in 1 Corinthians 15:24, then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom unto his Father. You're in his house, you're in his kingdom. It's delivered up to the Father. You hear the words, well done, thou faithful, a good and faithful servant. You're ushered into the heavenly realm, and you're going to spend eternity. Godly men and godly women are going to spend eternity with God in heaven. If you're here tonight, and you've never become a Christian, tonight is your night. How do I know? Yesterday's gone, tomorrow may never come. Tonight is your night. Obey the gospel. You need to come to Christ. Come to the cross. Leave your worldly cares behind. Your vanity, your pride, all the things of this world, leave them behind. Come to Christ. Come to him and believe. John 8:24. Unless you believe that I am he, you'll die in your sin. Repent, Luke 13:3. Confess, Romans 10:9-10. And be baptized. For what reason? The remission of sin, Acts 2:38. And what will be accomplished? God will save. The Lord will add, Acts 2:47, you to the church. You see this? You'll be in his house. And in his house, the blood of his son continually flows. So that once you're in his house and you live faithfully, as long as you're walking in the light, you keep the lights on in the house, the blood of his son, Jesus Christ, cleanseth, ETH, continual action. Cleanseth us from all sin. Why? Because no sin in heaven. When you leave this earth, you've got to be spotless and clean, a saint. And you will be if you're in the house of God living faithfully. The teaching is yours tonight. I'd love to see someone obey the gospel. Someone come to Christ. Think about these things as we stand and as we sing.